Welcome and good evening. Today is the second day of Christmas, and this is traditionally St. Stephen's Day, and we will acknowledge St. Stephen as the second prayer of the day today, but our readings are for the first Sunday after Christmas, and I'll be using the text for the first Sunday after Christmas. We're very grateful that a member of the parish, Lani Beuerman, is playing tonight. Mr. Bill Glisson is getting a well-deserved weekend off, and Lani, who was the head of the American Guild of Organists organization in Europe when they were teachers in Europe for many, many years, is a local member of the AGO, and we're always grateful when she can play for us. Many of you enjoyed her piano playing in the pre-service music on Friday night, or on Thursday night at Christmas Eve. In our bulletin tonight, you'll notice just a couple of things different than normal. One, the hymn of the day is split before and after the sermon, once in Royal David City. And instead of reciting the psalm, we'll be singing Joy to the World as a psalm hymn. And then our response tonight, instead of what we would normally sing, Praise God from whom all blessings flow, we'll be singing the third stanza of What Child Is This? But other than that, the service is as normal for Saturday night of spoken liturgy with hymns. So, welcome everyone. Let us stand and we begin with our brief order for confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us make confession to God. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy. For the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Through his Holy Spirit, he cleanses us and gives us power to proclaim the mighty deeds of God, who has called us out of darkness into the splendor of his light. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, direct us to do what pleases you, that being rich in good works of love, we bring honor to your Son, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And let us pray. Grant us grace, O Lord, that like Stephen, we may learn to love even our enemies and seek forgiveness for those who desire our hurt. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the Word of God. The first lesson is from Isaiah 61. The prophet declares, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with a beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its sprouts, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to sprout up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to sprout up before all the nations. For Zion's sake I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not be quiet, until her righteousness goes forth as brightness, and her salvation as a burning torch. The nation shall see your righteousness, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We stand for the hymn. Be seated. The second lesson is from Galatians 4. St. Paul writes,
But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God hath sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand. Gloria, gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria, gloria, alleluia, alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the second chapter, glory to you, O Lord. And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. And to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak to him, to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Oh.
Please be seated and turn in the back of your bulletins to page 9, continuing on with the Lord's Prayer as the head of the family should teach them in a simple way to his household. The second petition, reading together, Thy kingdom come. What does this mean? The kingdom of God certainly comes by itself without our prayer. But we pray in this petition that it may come to us also. How does God's kingdom come? God's kingdom comes when our Heavenly Father gives us his Holy Spirit, so that by his grace we believe his holy word and lead godly lives here in time and there in eternity. Now at the top of the previous page, let us pray together. Almighty God, you have poured upon us the new light of your incarnate word. Grant that this light, enkindled in our hearts, may shine forth in our lives. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. The text for the sermon is the second lesson from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. First, slaves to sin. Many Sundays out of the year, we make our confession of sins using the words, we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. And you know, the problem with familiar words is that they roll easily and thoughtlessly off the tongue, as if to say, yes, yes, we know this. Now let's get on with it. But if we drill down deeper, we may think of them as sort of only rhetorical, metaphorical, or symbolical. And by that, I mean that these words convey powerful images, but essentially don't strike home at the very heart of us. Essentially, we may not feel these words. So tonight, let's go deeper to the root of things. Years ago, comedian Eddie Murphy used to do this thing about being a poor child in the inner city. And as with the work of so many comedians, the bit was rooted in hurt. So when the other kids have money to buy novelties from an ice cream truck, one little boy gets taunted by another. I've got some ice cream, I've got some ice cream, but you don't got any, 'cause you're on the welfare and your daddy's an alcoholic. But then the one doing all the taunting suddenly drops his treat on the ground and he starts to cry. The poor child picks up the novelty and says, kiss it up to God. And then he begins to taunt the other, I got some ice cream, I got some ice cream, but you don't got any. You see, our bondage to sin is not rhetorical, metaphorical, or symbolical. We are born into a world not by choice. We get the biological mothers and fathers we get without our say-so. We get the bodies we get with the genetic makeup we get without our say-so. We are raised where and with whom we are raised without our say-so. We are born absolutely powerless over our situation. As kids and even as adults, we often compare ourselves to those who have more. We don't often think that we could have been like one born into a North Korean family despised by the ruling Kims, or like a Uyghur in China, or like a starving child in a drought-stricken African nation. Why is one child born loved and healthy, while another is born to a drug-addicted prostitute? You see, our slavery to sin is both about nature and nurture, who we be, where we come from, and with whom and where we live. And we may well be better treated by complete strangers than by our own relatives. And the bottom line on all this is that we cannot free ourselves. Yes, we can learn to make better choices. Yes, we can escape the cycle of poverty. Yes, we can succeed well beyond our beginnings. But what we cannot change is the basics of who we are genetically by birth and where we come from or all those past hurts. We also cannot change that we cannot, by our own reason or understanding, believe in Jesus Christ our Lord or come to him. He must come to us to free us. And that is Paul's powerful gospel. So the second phrase is sons of God. Now, if you were reading earlier just the first three verses of chapter 4 of Galatians, Paul has likened our situation by birth to that of a slave under a cruel master. Apparently, sometimes in that culture, a master would use up a slave until the slave was old and worn out, and then the master would set him free with no resources and no way to take care of himself. In that instance, it was very much how Kris Kristofferson described it long ago in his song, Bobby McGee, freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. I remember how in the 1980s, there were some Soviet Jews who were allowed to immigrate to Israel. And when they got there, they were asked where they wanted to live and where they wanted to work, but they were completely paralyzed because in the old USSR, they had always been told where to live and what to do. Paul declares the same thing we heard from Titus 2 on Christmas Eve. God the Father sent his Son to be born of the Virgin Mary and to be born subject to the curse of the law. He came to set free all those who are slaves to sin. And there is no sin and there is no bondage that is too big for Jesus. His death on the cross is enough for those of every time and every place. And Christ not only died, he is risen indeed, alleluia. Just a week ago at a memorial service on Sunday afternoon, we sang, he lives, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. It is well with my soul. Now let's back up just a minute to understand the cultural situation. A Greek child from a wealthy family was powerless as long as he was under the care of what was called a pedagogue. We would say something like a butler or somebody like a nanny. And it wasn't until his father declared him to be his son that he had the privileges of a son. And that typically happened somewhere between the ages of 15 and 18. And so the Greek in verse 5 is not generic. The verb is literally translated adopted as sons. So adopted as children is not even close. Adopted as sons. Once you were a slave, says Paul, but through your baptism into Christ's death and resurrection, you are adopted as sons. Remember, Paul uses exactly the same language in Romans 8. And our Lord says it earlier in John 8. If the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. In Christ, we are no longer slaves. We are sons because of the crucified, incarnate Son of God. So in holy baptism, we are members of Christ, hands, feet, arms, legs, and we are thus members of one another. No matter where we come from, no matter from whom we come, we are sons of God because of the Son. As members of the body of Christ, we are part of a family in which there are no distinctions based upon the particulars of our human birth. And that is why many of us receive much greater love from our church than we do from some of our relatives. Finally, the third is heirs of God. Paul makes clear that the Father not only sent his Son to the Virgin Mary's womb to take on our lot, our bondage to sin, in order to save us by his obedient death on the cross. The Father sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts in holy baptism. You can read about that on Pentecost in Acts 2:38. They repent, they are baptized, they receive the Holy Spirit. We are not only free, we are sons and we are heirs. So now the Holy Spirit cries out from within us, Abba, Father. Again, that is not our work. It's not our cooperating with God. It is all the very grace of God. The Father sends the Holy Spirit into our hearts to declare that we are God's own dear children. We are His. Now, I know this. Many of us have bought Powerball or Mega Millions tickets this week because the jackpot is bigger than anyone can imagine. So what if you won the jackpot? Well, you know that I'll call you if you do. What would you do with it, though, if you won? And how long would it be before you died and left it all to others? In other words, how long would you have that big prize? Now compare that with being a son of God through Jesus the Son and an heir. You already have an inheritance that cannot be taken from you. You won't have to leave it to anyone because you will always be a son and heir, even if this body dies. You have a future with God that is secure. So now think about how that changes everything. When the devil, the father of lies, sings an old familiar song in your ear as he does, you're no good, you're no good, you're no good, baby, you're no good, you can answer back to him, go to hell. I'm not listening to you. You know, so if you're driving in your car and it seems that your car is heading to the ABC store, you don't have to turn in. Or if you turn in, you don't have to go in. Or if you go in, you don't have to buy. Or if you buy, you don't have to open it. Or if you open it, you don't have to drink because you are a son and you are an heir. And one of these days, that craving will be completely gone. But even if you slip, that does not have to be the end of you because you can start over again with the help of God. And someday that craving will be gone for good, because that craving is really about seeking release from pain by falling into the abyss, and that's not your future. You are a son. You are an heir of God. The Holy Spirit is crying out from within you, Abba, Father, Daddy, help me. Set me free from this. An old friend of mine once did something incredibly stupid and childish. We were young men. He was arrested, and he didn't want anybody to know. So he called me with his one phone call, and he gave me the particulars. I didn't know what to do, so I called an older mentor who did not know him, and I asked, now what do I do? And the mentor gave me the name of a lawyer who then arranged bail for my friend, and I loaned my friend $50 at the time so he wouldn't have to explain what he had done with the $50, and in time he paid me back after he fessed up, and my mentor said to me, everybody will do something incredibly stupid at least once in his life. Don't be too hard on him. He was right. Our Father says, whatever you've done or left undone, whatever you've said or left unsaid, however stupid you may have been, no matter how ashamed you may be of it, don't listen to the old enemy when he says you're trash. He's a liar. For by your baptism into Jesus' death and resurrection, you are a son and an heir of God, and the Holy Spirit is crying out, Abba, Father, this one belongs to you, dear Father, even though she or he was incredibly stupid, she or he is free. So you are no longer slaves to sin. Even when you experience afresh the bondage to sin that manifests itself through the old Adam or the old Eve in you. And that sinful nature will not always be with you. The child of God in you can grow through the pain that is caused by your old sinful self. In other words, some of our stupidity, we still have to accept the consequences, like my friend did. You know, just couldn't stop listening to the old tempter from the pit of hell. But that's not who he was. That's not who you are. That's not who you're gonna be. You are a son of God through the Son Jesus. You are an heir with a limitless future. So today, the Son of God and Son of Mary actually comes in his supper, in the host, in the cup, to be born in you and me today. He will enter into every sin-sick cell in our bodies. He will know our needs and still our fears, not rhetorically, not metaphorically, not symbolically, but actually. And when we receive Jesus again, the Holy Spirit will cry out from within, "Abba, Father." And the Father will hear the Spirit's voice, and he will see the Son in us. And the Father will call us sons and heirs forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We sing stanzas 4, 5, and 6.
Our childhood's pattern, day by day, like us he grew. He was little, weak and helpless, tears and smiles, like us he knew. And he feeleth for our sadness, and he sharedeth in our gladness. And our eyes at last shall see him through his own redeeming love. For that child, so dear and gentle, is our Lord in heaven above. And he leads his children on to the place where he is gone. Not in that poor lowly stable with the oxen standing by we shall see him, but in heaven, set at God's right hand on high, when like stars his children crowned, all in white shall wait around.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray with the Lord Jesus Christ for the unity and renewal of his church on earth, for Bishops Eaton and Smith, for Francis Bartholomew and all bishops,
For all pastors, including Marvin Shedler, Robert Kupler, Peter Hoyer, Michael Bergbauer, Joel Kettner, and your servant, for all church workers, for Stephen ministers, for the people of God, and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, we pray for your whole church on earth, the body of Christ, that she may live in the freedom of adopted sons and heirs of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Generous Father, we thank you for the gift of life in this world. Guard and keep in safety all pregnant women and their babies, especially remembering Kelly Miller, Mandy Harrington, and their children. We give thanks for the birthdays of Heather Benson, Jordan Gorville, Gina Martuselli, Rose Weidman, Dan Cumbo, John Bell, Isley McCombs, and Jonathan Moore. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, we praise you for the gift of marriage and ask that you would shield husbands and wives from the taunts and lies of the old enemy. We ask your blessing this day upon those celebrating anniversaries, Stan and Jane Brunt, Fred and June Dahl, Gilbert and Karen Offen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Kind Father, help the sick and suffering, especially those who desire our prayers. Fran Perry, Barbara Colton, Maureen Ritchie, Maggie Hoyer, Fred Dahl, Clarence Peterson, Patty Messino, Kay Thompson, Alan Hunsberger, Arthur Peace, Doris Ullman, Lani Beuerman, Vivian Alexander, Dennis Hall, Donna Franklin, Arthur and Barbara Moore, Sue and Terry Miller, Bishop Mayfield, Stan Brunt Sr., Virginia Mao, Joe Aceto, John Cook, for an end to the pandemic and for those who mourn. We remember those persecuted for the faith, for those whose vocation is to guard and protect, for our enemies, for our shut-ins and their families, for those being treated for cancer, for those affected by the Nashville bombing, and those we name aloud or silently. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, we pray that all who receive the true body and most precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ will live like Saint Simeon, as ones prepared to depart in peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for just a couple of announcements. We will have no classes this week in the time between Thanksgiving and New Year's. And again, next weekend, all the service times will be as normal. This Thursday, a reminder from the treasurer that it's the final day that you can make gifts for 2020 to count towards charitable giving. You either need to drop them off before the office closes at 5, or be sure that they're postmarked on Thursday, December 31st, to get credit in terms of your own tax returns. The office will be closed on Friday for New Year's Day. Upcoming, for those who are interested in knowing more about the Lutheran Church or about how we understand Christianity, we have our new Disciples class on Saturday, the 16th of January at 9. And for those who are Lutherans looking to transfer to us, we have the new member orientation on Saturday, February 13th at 9. And the people that previously came to the new Disciples class also come to the new member orientation on February 13th, and we're welcoming new members. That's Transfiguration Weekend, February 13 and 14. Those are all the announcements. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Please bow or wave to people not of your household, expressing God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. You may be seated.
Let us pray. Loving Father, we rejoice in the great gift of your only Son, and pray that you may find joy in the gifts we bring in celebration. Teach us to give ourselves more fully to each other, trusting that our love will abide through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. We give you thanks, dear Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent in this end of the ages to save and redeem us and to proclaim to us your will. He is your word inseparable from you. Through him you created all things, and in him you take delight. He is your word sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. He there took on our nature and our lot, and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. It is he, our Lord Jesus, who fulfilled all your will and won for you a holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust in you. It is he who handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection. Taking bread and giving thanks to you, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Remembering then his life, death, and resurrection, we lift this bread and cup before you, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. We ask now, send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts of your church and gather into one all who share this, the true body and the most precious blood of your Son. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith in truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with your Holy Spirit in your holy church now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We pray together, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are we who were called to his supper. Amen. You may be seated. Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. May this your body strengthen and preserve me in the one true faith to life everlasting. Amen. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits to me? I will offer the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from all mine enemies. May this thy blood strengthen and preserve me, the one true faith, unto life everlasting. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus, friend of sinners. Let us rise. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his most precious blood keep you in his grace now and always. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, with the peace we find at your table, you urge us to resume the burden of the children of God. By your sacramental grace and power, guide us as we find maturity through the power of your sacrificial love. You are the Lord forevermore. Amen. I will strive to pray daily, worship weekly, read the Bible, serve at and beyond St. Matthew's, be in relationship to encourage spiritual growth in others, and give of my time, talents, and resources. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.